Good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming out on this beautiful evening. I'm Harold Holzer, director of the Roosevelt House, and it's a special treat for me to be sitting with a man I regard as one of the greatest historians in America. And I say that seriously, I don't say it to everybody who's here, and we have some really fine historians and writers here. Sean Wilentz, as you know from your programs, has written widely on the American past and on the American present, Magisterial Rise of American Democracy, one of the greatest books ever written on the American political experience. I won't dwell too much on the credits, you have them in your programs, but I will say, I'll make one more editorial comment, that I think what one of the things that sets Sean Wilentz apart is a kind of accessibility. His writing is not just for professional historians, it's for everyone, it has meaning, it has impact, great power, and great simplicity. I'm sure he's a great teacher as well, because he synthesizes so coherently, and I know we're all hungry to learn much more from him. I want to, before I start, offer a special welcome to our board member, Norton Garfinkel, who is here, and a special welcome to the gentleman who just made such an entrance, not only another member of our board of advisors, but the winner so deservedly last night of the Jacqueline Kennedy Onassis Award for Lifetime Achievement from the Municipal Arts Society, William Vandenhoever.
They're here.
So, from that lofty beginning...
Well, first, I must thank you very much.
Coming
from Harold Holzer, those are very, very high compliments indeed. I've read him on Lincoln. He's written a lot about Lincoln. Everything I write about Lincoln in here is indebted to what you've written, really. So, thank you very much.
Thank you. Well, that's it for the program.
That's it. It's called the Mutual Admiration Society.
Right.
We meet every third... No, never mind.
So... The book, which you see in front of you, is The Politicians and the Egalitarians. It covers a lot of chronological territory. And for those who need to begin at the beginning, Sean, tell us what you mean by the egalitarians and the politicians and how they interact or sometimes appear as a single person in American history.
Yes, they can. And noting that the most important word in the title is not a word at all, it's the ampersand, because it's about these two groups that often dislike each other or distrust each other immensely, but it's about their convergence. The book begins with two essays that posit that there are two keys to understanding American history. One is that partisan politics are inevitable and good, for the most part. The other is that there's an egalitarian tradition that runs from the very beginning of American history to the present that has had twists and turns and so forth, but there it is. So there are egalitarians and there are politicians. The thesis of the book, to the extent that it has a thesis, is that you can understand American political history as a series of convergences. When politicians, professional politicians, the people who actually get elected and run things, converge with the forces of egalitarianism that are very often outside, not entirely, but very often outside of the political system. It's those convergences that you can see extraordinary things happening in American history. I mean, it goes right back to the beginning with Thomas Jefferson, where there were egalitarians in these little societies, and they became the Democratic Republican Party in part because of Jefferson. You certainly see it in the 1850s. 1840s and 1850s with Lincoln and the abolitionists. You see the convergence in, I don't have to tell this audience, in 1932, 1933. You saw it in 1964, 65. Some of you may have seen the HBO special called All the Way, the play All the Way, which is an extraordinary play. But there, I think, in some ways, the whole thesis of my book is summed up better than I ever could present it, which was how Lyndon Johnson and Martin Luther King Jr. converged. The convergence of the politician and the egalitarian. It's not ordinary. It doesn't often happen. Very often the two are at odds. There are there's great disjunctures. Very often they're both. The liberal politicians and the egalitarians are all on the margins of American politics for a very long time. But there are these extraordinary moments. So the book is dedicated to try to not just trace some of those moments, but rather to give you some sense of how these two groups have fared over the last 253, almost 300 years now.
And you make the point early on in the book that recent historians have underestimated the insiders in deference to the visionaries or the moral leaders.
Right.
And I think clearly you're attempting a corrective here.
Correct. I mean, I think for a long time the egalitarians were not in the show, not in the picture. They were thought of as kind of nutty. I remember the abolitionists, when I was in college, people thought the abolitionists as displaced, nutty people who somehow didn't get it right. They deserve to have their story told, and the radicals, the egalitarians, had to be written back into American history. But for reasons that are both intellectual and, I believe, political and cultural, we went too far in that direction. To the point where politicians, they weren't written out of the story, but they're considered to be impediments to democracy, almost across the board. Or if they're not impediments, they're kind of the people who are there to make sure that it doesn't get out of hand. That's their function. Or they take all the good ideas from the egalitarians and sort of denature them, and then they get all the credit, and the egalitarians are off to the side. That can't be true. It cannot be true. You wouldn't get anything done of any substance whatsoever if that was true. There would have been no Emancipation Proclamation if that had not been true, because that was because of the war that Lincoln's election sparked. You certainly wouldn't have had a New Deal if that is true. So I thought that it was about time to try to not simply stand up for the politicians. I like politicians generally. I have a soft spot for politicians, good politicians, many of them. But also to try to understand how the two come together. That is not an opposition, hence the ampersand. Politicians egalitarians can be exasperating. You know, they're exasperating. They don't have any responsibility to anybody besides themselves. They can say whatever they want. There's a certain tone of irresponsibility to being an egalitarian, because you can say what you want, and you don't have to pay the price. Politicians have a different universe to deal with. They are responsible to public opinion, and to the Constitution of the United States, among other things. So there are these two groups that don't like each other very much, but in fact they need each other more than they sometimes realize.
We could make a case that there would have been generations of egalitarian moral leaders spurring or sparring with politicians, but again, this is a point that you make, that there is an anti-political tradition that comes with the founding. Maybe inspired by George Washington and his disdain for politics and the absence of much partisan politics in his first term.
Yes.
How is that ingrained in American life? I think it's like it's lasted for 300 years don't like politicians.
We have it today in all over the place. Going back, as you said, Harold, to Washington, there was a feeling that parties were factions that were going to dissolve the common good, the commonwealth. It was going to be a kind of vehicle for ambition, personal ambition, and it would have nothing to do with what the people actually wanted. Better to have a system where the gentleman and property and standing and liberality and light all came together and decided what the common good really was. That's sort of what the framers had in mind. But this country is much too... too many clashing interests for that to be possible. Nevertheless, the idea that parties and politicians were somehow a damper on democracy, indeed anti-democratic, that they were bad for democracy, has persisted. You can see it in the 1830s and 40s when Jackson was coming up. The Whig Party had a lot of that sentiment in it, that the Jacksonians, these politicians who hang around with, you know, who have patronage. Oh, what a terrible thing, patronage, yikes. You know, it's all very corrupt. In fact, it's anti-political because it says that democracy is essentially corrupt because parties are the ways that democracy happens. You saw it in the aftermath of Reconstruction with Henry Adams and that crowd, the liberal Republicans, the so-called mugwumps later on. You saw it actually in the Confederacy of the United States. The one greatest experiment in non-party politics in American history was the Confederate States of the Union, which drafted a constitution that really did make parties marginal, and they hated parties. You saw what happened to the Confederate States of America, but in no small degree because they couldn't own their own political disputes. They were at each other's throats all the time, quite apart from what the Union Army was doing.
And Jefferson Davis had no natural political constituency in his Congress. It's a really good point.
I mean, there are so many, I forget the number, but there are more secretaries of war in those 4 years, secretaries of the Treasury, et cetera, et cetera. It's a revolving cycle of people coming in and out because it was politically incoherent. Politically incoherent. And the conceit appears today. I mean, you hear it all the time. To me, it's essentially undemocratic. It has an idea that somehow there's either a very lofty group of people or a more populist group of people who can really figure out how government works.
And Jefferson, who you ascribe both characteristics to uniquely, and we were, some of us in this room were here a few weeks ago when Annette Gordon expounded on Jefferson and his complications, but doesn't he also add to the perplexity here with his inaugural address,
yes,
by saying we're all Democrats, we're all Federalists?
Yes.
But then he's a political operative at the same time.
I mean, he knew what he was doing. As Harold said, Jefferson gives a very famous first inaugural address after a bitter, bitter election that had to be settled in the House of Representatives, right? And the country was really deeply divided. There had been soldiers drilling and one party took over rather than the other. So it was imperative in the aftermath of that of Jefferson to give an inaugural address, that was going to heal this tremendous breach. I mean, it was so bad, John Adams didn't even show up to the inauguration. He was so angry. You know, it was a really bitter, bitter struggle. So he gave an inaugural address in which he said, "We are all Republicans, we are all Federalists," which has been taken to be a kind of cornerstone of how Jefferson was anti-partisan. We all come together. Read the speech again. Mm-hmm. "We are all Republicans and we are all Federalists, and this is what we believe." And then he proceeds to read the Republican platform. What he had in mind, and he truly believed this, although he was going to be disabused of it within a couple of years, was that many of the Federalists really agreed with him more than they thought they did. And he was going to be able to bring the honest, capable Federalists over to his party and isolate the crazies out there, most of them from Massachusetts. That didn't work because the Federalists actually were a party and it was just going to give him headaches. And you know, then he got much more partisan as he goes along.
Quite a second election, too.
Well, that's right. And he crushed. I mean, talk about having a partisan, you know, he did very, very well. But there is this ambiguity. I mean, there are people who, political figures very often, who will be anti-partisan partisans. I mean, if I want to get my party through, what I do is I accuse the other party of being partisan. They're all a bunch of narrow-minded partisans. I, with my party, have the interests of the nation at heart. Well, that's an old ploy. Mm-hmm. I mean, we can see through that, right? With Jefferson, though, because of the nobility of the extraordinary moment, because it was so early and because of the nobility of his prose, it sounded as if he was saying something. Well, he was, but he was doing something different as well.
So you've helped move the chronology a little bit here, because you mentioned the founding of the Whig Party, which sort of has an anti-rabble mentality to it.
Even if people like Lincoln in the Whig Party were revolutionizing that kind of what had been a conservative view and making it much more democratic.
And more opportunity-oriented.
Precisely.
And business-oriented.
Right.
And pro-immigration.
And pro-immigration.
Which is something I try to talk about today. But you take two of the so-called egalitarians in the run-up to the Civil War and a little bit during the Civil War and run them through the Sean Wilentz ringer a little bit. It's very unpopular to take on the influence, the magnetic foresight of John Brown, the heroism of John Brown, and the influence of Frederick Douglass, two of the egalitarians But you sort of do, especially with John Brown. So why isn't he the brave, great hero who simply was overwhelmed by Robert E. Lee and the others? And why, well, we'll get to Douglas after.
Well, he was brave, self-dramatizing. He was a terrorist.
That's what you say.
He was a terrorist. In Kansas, before Harper's Ferry, there was a struggle going on, but he committed something that was no less than a war crime. So let's not gainsay. Just because he was on the side of right doesn't mean that we can look upon him with equanimity. There's no excuse for that kind of thing. Now, John Brown's idea was that he could rouse up a force. And you can understand why he came from where he came from, because he began his plotting at a time when anti-slavery politics really did look like they were getting nowhere. You know, after the Compromise of 1850, which you know about, I mean, it looked like the anti-slavery cause was in bad trouble, and you can see why someone then might say, well, the only thing we do to get rid of this abominable institution, to end the suffering of so many people, is to have a violent revolution. You can see that. I could get it. But after 1854, there's a political revolution going on that really is serious about getting rid of slavery and is gathering mass support.
And the founding of a new political party.
The Republicans are there. John Brown and his radical fellow were saying, no, they're just getting in the way, these people. They don't really mean it. They're even worse than the slaveholders, because they're getting in the way of the real revolution that has to occur. Those were John Brown's politics, mm-hmm. in effect. And in some ways, he did more. He did help bring the Civil War about, I argue. But the way that he did it was completely topsy-turvy. By doing the raid at Harper's Ferry, where he is overwhelmed by Robert E. Lee and the American forces who are there, he commits an act of treason. I mean, let's just call it what it is.
Because he overtakes a federal installation.
He's attacking his own government's fort.
Right.
But regardless of that, let's not get hung up on words. What he did was he really scared the Republicans. Because the Republicans knew very, very well that every single slaveholder was going to say, see, John Brown, he's the Republican. That's what you're going to get if you vote for those Republicans. They are really interested in slitting our throats and causing slave insurrections. William Henry Seward, the governor of, you know, former governor of New York, senator of New York, was the most of the radicals within the Republican Party. He was the most outspoken anyway with the irrepressible conflict. He gets scared. He's worried.
And Lincoln, of course, there's two interesting moments. One is that he's in Kansas when John Brown is executed,
right.
and has to comment on how he's not sympathetic. And, of course, when he comes to New York, he has to address John Brown at Cooper Union. So he's an anomaly. He's not a Republican.
But he handles it very, very
yeah.
well. He says, look, we believe in anti-slavery, but we don't believe in treason. And he was able to own that. Lincoln did not scare in that situation. He absolutely was clear about where the differences were, but also where the similarities were. He wasn't going to say that John Brown is just a terrible man. He said, look, the cause he fought for is my cause, but we're going to do it under the Constitution of the United States. We're not going to start killing people. We're not going to do it. So in the fight for the nomination in 1860, the fact that Seward was considered this radical and Lincoln was the more moderate, well, I think that it helped, wasn't decisive, but it helped get Lincoln the nomination. The fact that Lincoln got the nomination made all the difference in the election. The lower North, New York, Pennsylvania, etc. Had Seward been nominated, I'm not so sure that the lower North would have necessarily gone for the Republicans. It's entirely possible.
And I think Indiana and Illinois were questions. Illinois went Democratic 4 years earlier.
That's right. So, for all of those reasons, John Brown, by scaring the Republicans and getting Lincoln the nomination, did a great service for American history.
And that's as much as you'll say.
But that's it.
But so Frederick Douglass is the, maybe not so much the egalitarian principle of the 1860s. I mean, he certainly is the hero now.
Yes, absolutely.
John Stopher and David Blight and other historians, Jim Oakes, all of them have written about the neglected influence of Frederick Douglass. And he was influential. I mean, he was the first African-American to have an audience with the President of the United States alone in conference. And I think you count three meetings. I actually think there was a fourth.
Really?
Because Douglas talks about having a meeting with him late at night at the soldiers' home.
Really?
Lincoln's Camp David.
I see.
And it's in his reminiscence for an 1880s era collection of reminiscences. And I take him at his word. Why would he have made that?
Did he say
up?
What happened?
Very little about it.
Yeah,
they
talk
politics.
Right.
They talk re-election. So it's 64.
Right.
But Lincoln sort of uses him in an interesting way, because this is the mastery that great politicians have when they have an egalitarian who's pushing, seeming to push the agenda. But tell us about what you think of the relationship.
Well, look, Frederick Douglass is a giant in American history, no question. And he escaped slave. The narrative we know about Frederick Douglass and his contributions are enormous. But when it came to the crisis, the secession crisis, and then the war itself, like many of the Garrisonians, although he had kind of split from the Garrisonians by this time, Douglass was skeptical of Lincoln. He had a reason to be skeptical about Lincoln. Who was this Abraham Lincoln? He came late to the cause. He hadn't really been involved in anti-slavery politics too much before 1854. Who is this guy?
So, and he was brutal to him after the first inaugural.
Well, he reads the first inaugural incorrectly, I believe. He doesn't get what Lincoln's talking about.
He says he's a slave catcher.
He says that, you know, it was the Corwin Amendment, and he was going to, you know, he threw the whole cause into the sewer. I mean,
we should add that Frederick Douglass has his own monthly newspaper at this point, so he's not only orating around the country, around the North, but he's publishing.
He's very influential, and but he really trashes the first inaugural. He doesn't get what Lincoln's trying to do, because he's coming at it as an abolitionist would. Well, he has these, perhaps, four, but certainly three meetings that we know about with Lincoln. On the first occasion, he's really angry with Lincoln. Lincoln isn't doing enough to advance emancipation. He's not doing enough to enlist free blacks in the cause, in the Union Army. It's taking forever to Lincoln to actually approve that. So he goes to the White House, prepared to give Lincoln a piece of his mind. Now, the very fact that Lincoln invited him to the White House is important, because he is the first guy, black man, to come to the White House. So there's a certain, he's impressed that Lincoln at least is going to willingly do that. He may, you know, have racist jokes in this background, but he is going to do this, and he takes Douglass seriously.
And he doesn't make him stand?
Not at all.
Right.
He treats him as an equal in his presence. They are equal. He allows Douglass to say his bit. He listens. He says, you know, you misunderstand me, and this is what I'm trying to do, and here is what I'm trying to say, and we disagree, but you have to take it on faith that we're really in this together. We're more together than we're not. And then he promises to give, as I recall in this meeting, Douglass a commission to go to Mississippi.
Well, the brilliant thing he says is, if you don't think we're recruiting enough troops, why don't you recruit troops? You're the person that they listen to.
You go do it.
And he wrote the great broadside, Men of Color, to Arms.
To Arms. So
better to die free than live slave.
To live as a slave.
Yeah.
And so Douglass leaves the White House saying, this guy's great. You know, he came to mock and left to cheer. And so in that way, Lincoln was showing, he was manipulating, but he was also understanding. He got it, Lincoln did. Real political gift. Second meeting, it's 1864, the election is coming, the radical abolitionists want to run somebody else besides Lincoln. They think Lincoln's terrible, he's not really fighting the war very well, he's not doing enough. Yeah, the Emancipation Proclamation, but there's more. And Douglass comes to the White House once again, going to give Lincoln a piece of his mind. This time, Lincoln listens to him. This was the time when he gave the so-called John Brown scheme, where he was going to send Douglass out to try and, you know, recruit, bring the slaves are not coming fast enough to Union lines, he tells Douglass. You have to be the one who's going to.
Well, we may lose, he says.
Yes.
We may lose the election, and McClellan will, if the Democrat wins in 1864, he'll cancel the Emancipation Proclamation.
And
I may have said forever free, maybe it'll stand in court, but at least get more enslaved people out of slavery,
out of
Union Army help.
To join the line, to join our effort.
That's funny that you call it a John Brown plan.
Well,
that's interesting.
Later on, Douglass said something along the lines of, he's turned me into John Brown, right? I'm going to go down and be John Brown. Well, it's a little different being an appointee of the President of the United States to go and do this than attacking the American government.
But he writes a real plan. It's like four-page
handwritten.
Yes,
he gets it going.
Plan.
Now, you know, Sherman takes Atlanta, everything, the political situation turns. It's not necessary for him to do that. But, again, Douglas leaves the White House saying how wonderful this was, how wonderful Lincoln is. Lincoln is a great man. And then the final meeting is just after the second inaugural, and it's a very poignant moment. It's one of the great moments in American history, as far as I'm concerned, where Douglas, it's afterwards, they're back at the White House, and there's a, you know, the celebration is going on, and Douglas is barred at the door by the soldiers. He's a black man. They don't want to let him in. They don't think black people are allowed into the White House. Lincoln hears about this, says, no, let him in. And then
first he sneaks in through a window, actually.
Oh, is that
according
right?
According to Douglas.
He knows so much more about this.
No, but it's okay. Your interpretation is great. He comes in through a window, and then they bar him again. And
is that right?
Then Lincoln says
then
those
Lincoln's,
words.
Okay, very good. So he says, that's my friend Douglas. You know, bring Douglas in. So Douglas comes in, and I'm going to get it incorrect, but I'm going to paraphrase what the exchange was.
I won't correct.
Which is along the lines of, what did you think of my speech? And Douglas said, it was a sacred effort, sir.
Line. But Lincoln also is there in front of, first of all, he makes them break the line. And Douglas, according to one of his elaborate reminiscences, I'll wait. No, come. And then he says, there is no one whose opinion I value more than yours.
Than yours. So that was
a day, a historic day.
An historic moment. I mean, talk about the politicians, the egalitarians. If there's a glorious moment in that history, that was it, in many ways.
And I think that
or symbolic, anyway.
The story that you retell about the their planning this liberating effort in case Lincoln loses is a moment when you call Lincoln a principled partisan.
That's right.
It's a moment when he, even if it's unrealistic, he demonstrates a yearning to get this right before he goes.
That's right.
It happens, you know.
Can I do one thing to illustrate, though?
Of course.
Can I do some reading? Can I read one bit of Frederick Douglass?
Absolutely. And while you find it, I'll say one more thing.
Do go.
Because you have to check.
Yeah, I have to find it.
The moment when he talks to Douglass about going into slave territory is a moment where I think Lincoln is in the deepest of depression. It's where Henry Raymond, the editor of the New York Times, has said to him, you're not going to win. You have to abrogate the Emancipation
right.
Proclamation. And he writes that blind memorandum saying we're going to lose and makes his cabinet sign a cooperation agreement, sight unseen, which is absurd. And then he sees Douglass. It's
right.
all in that same period.
Right.
And then 3 days, 4 to 5 days later, Sherman.
Yeah.
So it's a topsy-turvy emotional
period. Deus, we call it Sherman ex machina.
Right.
In 1876, Douglass gives a very important, long, important speech about Lincoln. And he says things like Lincoln was the white man's president. He says things that are trying to explain what Lincoln, how he and Lincoln were different. But then he comes around to what I think is really the central point of my book. I mean, you know, I didn't script him to do this, but he says it anyway very, very nicely. And you remember, the argument was always that Lincoln was trying to fight for union rather than for emancipation. It was all about the union, and that emancipation was an afterthought.
Right. Which you puncture in the book.
Well, you demolished it very, very well in your book, and I just came along and said the same thing.
Must be why I liked it.
Now, this is Douglass on Lincoln. Had he put the abolition of slavery before the salvation of the Union, he would have inevitably driven from him a powerful class of the American people and rendered resistance to rebellion impossible. So if he'd gone out and just talked about emancipation, half the North would have rebelled. He wouldn't have gotten anywhere. He would have lost the war. Viewed from the genuine abolition ground, Mr. Lincoln seemed tardy, cold, dull, and indifferent. But measuring him by the sentiment of his country, a sentiment he was bound as a statesman to consult, he was swift, zealous, radical, and determined. That's the division of labor. Mm-hmm. Which Douglass came to understand. I don't think he understood it at first, but he came to understand it. And that's really the key to the whole thing. And it's why Lincoln, I mean, Lincoln is an extraordinary figure, but he was an egalitarian politician, Lincoln. No question.
And Douglass, I always like to recall that Douglass gives this great speech. It's the it's April 14th, so it's the anniversary of the assassination.
Right.
In front of a gigantic bronze statue of Lincoln with what is now a totally politically incorrect kneeling slave or rising slave,
right.
Not dressed, but it was paid for by the freedmen of Washington.
Right.
So it's an interesting, but he was the speaker.
He was.
Grant pulled the drape, but wouldn't speak, wouldn't say a word. Taciturn.
There we are.
Fellow.
Right.
So we have to move on to our Roosevelt group, of course.
Yes.
Teddy, you talk a lot about, you do a deep dive into his political mistakes, like not running for a full second term in 1908, and his sort of moving into, well, his reform work, and then moving into this Don Quixote moment in 1912. So he was both also at his best, an egalitarian reformer, partisan.
Yeah, I mean, Teddy Roosevelt was a party politician, a very good party politician. People forget this because they think about him as the trust buster, they think about him as, you know, as a reformer, which he was, but he came into politics from a very genteel background, but very early learned the importance of party politics, of partisanship. During the famous, was it 1884 election, right? Mm-hmm. Rather than to go with many of his social class, the New York upper crust, he did not go along with those who would not support the terrible James G. Blaine. No, he was not a mugwump, he supported Blaine. And there are those who thought that that was the end of his political career, because from his precincts, that was a terrible thing to have done. That was awful. But he understood that he was going to stay with the party because he believed that the party was, in the end, something that had to be respected. He was not going to lightly divorce himself from the party. He becomes a very, very capable, well, we all know the history of Roosevelt, governor, all the rest of it, right up to become vice president. Mark Hanna says that damn cowboy's going to be president of the United States. He's president of the United States. But as president of the United States, he has to deal with people like Mark Hanna, other people in the Republican Party. He becomes a very skilled wire puller of the Republican Party. He basically makes the Republican Party his as president. While he's busting the trusts and all the rest of it, he is a very, very capable politician.
And but, choosing his vice president slash successor?
Well, exactly. He says we're going to have William Howard Taft is going to be the man who's going to carry on my program. Politicians may be worthwhile. They're not omniscient. They don't know everything because, of course, we know the story that Taft, he doesn't run in 1908. Taft comes in. He's very disappointed in Taft. He considers Taft a traitor. And so he wants to get back into the fray, having left the fray. And he tries for the Republican nomination in 1912. And he wins all the primaries. And, you know, it's a rigged system.
It's a rigged system. He loses New York.
They had no superdelegates, but if there had been superdelegates, it would have been right. But he loses the nomination because the party's in the hands of the President of the United States. Right? The President of the United States is going to control the party. So what does Roosevelt do? He decides to just go all out with reform and to run as the head of a third-party progressive party ticket. Now, at one level, you can read that campaign, the 1912 campaign, the Progressive Party campaign, as a harbinger of, well, of the New Deal in many ways. I mean, he's standing up for things that are not going to come to fruition for a very long time to come. Some of them Wilson will get done, votes for women, things like that. But others will have to await, social insurance and so forth, will have to await the New Deal. So in some ways, that campaign is a glorious moment in the history of American liberalism. But what it meant was that Roosevelt was through as far as the Republican Party was concerned. It was done. He was out. He was a traitor. So he went on this quixotic crusade. He was happy to see Wilson win. He was happy to see Taft lose, to be sure. But that was it for him in the Republican Party. Now, let's suppose he hadn't done that. Let's suppose he was content to let Taft lose to Wilson. Had he come back and stayed in the Republican Party, he'd remained the partisan that he had been. Chances are he could have won the 1916 election. In fact, he probably would have won the 1916 election. The Republican candidate in 1916 was Charles Evans Hughes, not the most, what shall we say, effervescent figure in American politics. And Hughes barely lost to Wilson. And Wilson, you know, had the fight of his life.
Went to bed thinking he might have lost.
He might have lost. So what Roosevelt ended up doing was handing the Republican Party to its old guard. I mean, the progressives are still going to be around. There was La Follette. I mean, there were going to be people there. But it really ensured that the old guard that he took, you know, he took his people out. It was going to be the Harding-Coolidge era. You can't blame it on Teddy Roosevelt, but he didn't help matters any. And it's precisely because he lost his political chops. He was a mixture of arrogance, a mixture of hurt, it was a mixture of a lot of things. He could not imagine America without Teddy Roosevelt as president, and he paid the price.
It's a fascinating way of looking at it. The 1916 is a fascinating way of looking at 1912. We have to spend 1 second before we get to FDR, which our audience loves to hear about, talking about 1928, when America decides it's not going to be partisan again because there's a businessman who's made a huge amount of money, Herbert Hoover, who is beyond partisanship, and he wins by a huge margin and proves incapable of dealing with politics. Is that right in the argument?
Right in the argument. I mean, if there's a progressive, capital P, non-party type, it was Herbert. Herbert Hoover only became a Republican after he lost to Roosevelt. I mean, he became a Republican. He was a Republican in name, but he wasn't a party Republican in the way that he became such an embittered anti-New Dealer. He was the absolute ne plus ultra of, you know, the man of expertise. You know, he had studied Agricola and mining, and he had written about these things. He was a very learned man, and he had Belgian Relief and all the rest of it. He was the man who could get things done, who was a man he was a kind of progressive in that sense, detached from politics. You can only really have good government without sordid politics. Et voila.
Right.
And then the rest you know.
And FDR, a man who can deal with Rexford Tugwell and James Farley.
Correct.
He's doing both and succeeding by being a politician and having a brain trust.
That's right. I mean, there are those who don't like to think about FDR as a politician, but come on, he was a masterful politician.
What about Eleanor? Is she one of the egalitarians
she
who
is.
Influences?
That's interesting. I should have written more about
Eleanor.
Yeah,
I was thinking
this.
She maybe belongs in.
Well, she is the first. I mean, she is the first of many things. But I mean, there are people. You know, she's certainly a politician to the extent that she's married to the President of the United States, so she's on that side. But she sees her position as one that can reach out in ways that the president could not. You know, she can be an egalitarian as no president could be, yet she's also very much on the inside. So I think that she invents a position that hadn't existed in American politics. And, you know, no one's done it quite as well as, you know, since.
Right. I mean, she definitely is pushing back with her civil rights agenda.
Absolutely.
Through every part of the New Deal, usually without much success.
Right, but she is there and she is doing
she's
it.
Doing
she's
it.
Determined. And she also builds links, though. I mean, she is very clear that she can do things in terms of alliances that no president, no Democrat, no person in power could do.
Briefly, because I want to get to just a few more eras, you know, in one era and out the other. Unfortunately, it's a bad joke. And I'm going to do, this is going to be a multi-generational question.
Okay.
So, President Clinton, famously, not helpfully to Hillary, said 8 years ago, in South Carolina, we don't give enough credit to Lyndon Johnson for the Civil Rights Act, we give all the credit to Martin Luther King. That was not a very politic thing to say, and it didn't help her in South Carolina. Barack Obama won handily and was on his way. But what do we make of Bill Clinton's analysis? He said it in a hurt way. It wasn't. But
Actually, I think it was Hillary who said that. And,
really?
And Bill said something different in South Carolina about Jesse Jackson and the primary and so forth. It was Hillary who said, you know, it takes a president, if you will.
Okay.
It wasn't that we should not credit Martin Luther King, but she said in the end, you know, she was running for president. She was not running for movement leader. The job was president. And to the extent that she thought that Senator Obama was kind of playing, you know, a more movement type of persona, I think she was trying to say, you know, you really have to be a president to do that. Now, and she got in a lot of trouble for it because she was, I remember the Times blasted her because they said it was a racist thing to say that a black man requires a white man to get anything done, which was not her point at all. Her point is actually the same point as I had it first, I might say. I mean, some of these essays, you know, in here go back 25 years, so it's not, you know, I've been thinking about this a long time. But that's quite right. I mean, there is this division of labor, and there is this conjunction that occurs. And if you're going to give, you know, you cannot give Martin Luther King Jr. all of the credit for the civil rights reforms of 1964 and 1965. He is indispensable. He is all, you know, without him, it would have been impossible. Without him, also the way that he led the movement, leadership, not just moral character, but he was a leader. He was a politician too, by the way. I mean, very, very much so. And if you, there's a very good book, some very good books about Selma and how he handled the Selma situation, which shows a really astute politician, but he was a great moral force. He was a saint. Okay? But saints don't get laws passed, at least not in the United States of America. Lyndon Johnson accomplished something extraordinary, which was to take the New Deal. You know, he was FDR was his idol. There's a famous photograph, we were talking about it earlier, of FDR and Lyndon Johnson. And Lyndon Johnson, you know, you think he's going to go to the moon. He's so happy to be seeing his idol. And he brought that sensibility to the presidency, which accidentally, terribly, horribly, he shouldn't have been president, but he was. And he proceeded to then try to expand upon that New Deal legacy with the Great Society and the War on Poverty and all the rest of the things that you know about. But he also conjoined that, and here's where King comes in, with the Civil Rights Movement, which was, when you think about the history of American liberalism, American reform, just step back for a moment, that's a big, big deal to get those two things together, the argument for economic equality or justice and racial justice conjoined in one moment. It's extraordinary. It begun under President Kennedy, but it really flourished under Johnson, that embrace.
And he sort of co-opts the moral argument by giving the "We Shall Overcome" speech in Congress.
Well, he enlists in the Civil Rights Movement, and he is very clear. He says, Johnson, I have some quotations. I can find that without the Civil Rights Movement, it never would have happened. Mm-hmm. He's not taking all the credit for this. He's not saying, yeah. Very nice, Dr. King. Go, you know, Lyndon Johnson. He certainly had that in him, the Lyndon Johnson part. But he was very clear. He said, without the Civil Rights Movement, we would not be standing here today. This was what got it. We were nothing. They were everything. And we just got it done.
So much to cover. I'm just going to ask one more question without even talking about outcomes or possible outcomes. This is a very strange thing. So we have two movement outsiders running against partisan politics as we know it.
Right.
Rigged systems, whatever.
Right.
One completely upends his political party, and one comes significantly short. You know, he may argue that it's close, but it's not close.
Right.
But has it ever happened before? Do you know that both political parties had their legitimacy challenged in this way and emerged this way?
I mean, you know, in the 1850s, 1860s, the Whigs fell apart in 1854, but the Democrats did divide in 1860. So, you know, the crisis of slavery was a pretty big one. So that's not the same year, but it's close enough.
Mm-hmm.
But what's happened this year, I think, I mean, we've seen parties fall apart before, right? The Federalists in 1800 had a great crisis. They divided. They limped it another 15 years, the Whig Party in 1854. The Republican Party has been in a state of crisis for at least 20 years, in my view. And it only made the crisis worse by its leadership stoking a base on social, racial, and cultural issues and raising the possibility that basically you could repeal modernity. And it didn't work. Modernity was not repealed. But the base was very angry that it was not repealed. You know, remember, I mean, you know, the Republican leadership was promising that they were going to not get Barack Obama elected, and then when he did get elected, they were going to say he can never be reelected. And what do we get? Gay marriage.
Healthcare.
But I mean, I'm thinking of the cultural issues. I mean, they just did not. So they stoked up the space. They got into a fever pitch. The process had occurred. The Republican Party became a kind of ideological outlier. It ceased to be a normal political party. And Donald Trump just walked right in.
So is the Republican Party, in your view, going the way of the Whigs?
No, I don't think so. Because it's too powerful at the local level. It owns, you know, most of the state houses, most of the The national level, though, it's in a real crisis, and it's going to be interesting to see, because if Trump wins this election, I thought I heard a shudder through the crowd. Well, there ought to have been a shudder in the crowd, in my view. If Trump wins this election, the Republican Party is no longer the Republican Party that's recognizable to anybody. You know, I mean, you know, I won't mention any names, but it's not the political party, that the Republican Party that Ronald Reagan.
Right, and whatever he's saying to Speaker Ryan, he can, if he can be consistent, he can create his own agenda.
He'll be the president, you know, he'll be the president of the United States. I mean, the party will be very, very different. Now, if he loses, then there's going to be a power struggle because, you know, don't forget, the person who finished second to him in the primaries was not Jeb Bush. It was Ted Cruz. The movement conservatives are very, very strong. I happen to be, actually, I spent some time with Governor Bush recently, and, you know, they still think that they are the Republican Party, too. They regard Trump as no Republican at all, no conservative at all. But there's still a big difference between Ted Cruz and Jeb Bush. So I think there's going to be a tremendous power struggle, and we'll see how it comes out. Maybe Speaker Ryan will be the person to adjudicate that. But don't forget, Speaker Ryan's politics are very, very conservative as well.
Right.
So it's not as if we're talking, you know, if Paul Ryan's the moderate, then you have a very conservative party. If John Kasich is the moderate, you have a very conservative party. Mm-hmm. So I think the Republican Party is in a crisis, and we're going to see another party emerging, and I have no idea how it's going to work out. With the Democrats, a lot of those divisions, they're familiar in a funny way. They're not the same, but they kind of rhyme, going back to the 60s. I mean, the division between the new politics, anti-Vietnam War, and the Hubert Humphrey wing of the Democratic Party. All right. Robert Kennedy would have made all the difference, in my view. But it was not to be. But that tension within the party got rearticulated in the 80s and 90s with the advent of Clinton, where the old party was having tremendous difficulty at the national level. You know, Carter didn't work out. So these tensions have been there. And you could see it during the Clinton administration, where the left wing of the party thought that he was a traitor to democratic ideals, to the ideals of the New Deal, et cetera. Clinton was saying, hey, wait a minute, guys, I'm dealing with Reagan and Gingrich, and I got to get something done here, and please understand what I'm doing. Well, it didn't always work out. But those tensions were there. They came together. They managed to hold together. Obama came out of the new politics wing in some ways of the party, but he managed as president to bring it together pretty well, and then the left didn't like him so much after a while. So these tensions have been there. What's extraordinary about this year was that somebody from outside the party, I mean, Senator Sanders is not a Democrat, you know, managed to get this large group of people. Now, I happen to think, though, that it's not what people think it is. The way it's described is the establishment versus the insurgents, right? The people versus the establishment, right? That's the way it's presented. Am I wrong about that? Okay. If the establishment includes the vast majority of black voters, and if the establishment includes the preponderance of organized labor, then it's not the establishment. Or rather, we have to think of different terms to understand what the establishment versus the insurgency is. I mean, Senator Sanders has done an amazing job of bringing the issues to bear on inequality and so forth. I think it's extraordinary what he's done. And that comes out of 2008. We can talk about that afterwards if you want. But the coalition that he has is basically, you know, universities, young people, and then sort of millennial penumbra, which is, you know, 10 million people, plus rural white voters. Now, if that's the people, that's part of the people, but it's not all of the people. So the insurgency, I think, is one that, in terms of bringing the issues in, which is what I think he began wanting to do, it's had a very salutary effect upon the Democratic Party and the nation. It's just what Secretary Clinton said the other night. But I don't think the Democratic Party is anywhere near the state of crisis the Republican Party. I mean, I suppose that's my point. That the Democratic Party, you know, establishment, non-establishment, it is going to cohere. It is going to be there. There are going to be people who are upset, but I think in the end it's going to come together. And we'll see. This could be, if you're a Democratic liberal, this could very well be a very good year. Don't quote me. You're filming this, I know.
We're actually live on live stream.
Oh, we're on live stream. but I it was a conditional. Could be. It depends on, you know, how the party comes together or not.
So I've gone on too long, but we need to invite you to join in with questions. If you have a question, well, this gentleman is here, and we have a microphone right in front of you.
It was very interesting. I wanted to talk about how you set up the discussion, and then a couple of examples you used, and one or two more that I have, mm-hmm. that maybe it didn't quite fit to what mm-hmm. I understood your setup to be. Mm-hmm. So your setup, as I understood it, was you have politicians who have a lot of responsibilities mm-hmm. and have to essentially be political, mm-hmm. and you have egalitarians, mm-hmm. or we might call them the movement, mm-hmm. who can be sort of more straightforward, go after their objective, and then they sort of come together in this alliance, in a sense. Mm-hmm. But the thing that didn't quite sit with me mm-hmm. was, it seems to me there are plenty of people, leaders, in the egalitarian movements who are, in fact, quite political. Mm. So, if you gave the example, in fact, of Eleanor Roosevelt, mm-hmm. who was really an egalitarian first, happened to be married to a president right. who was quite political. Martin Luther King, who, besides the politics to manage Selma, was tremendous in terms of managing the broader political structure. And even if you take it to today, the Black Lives Movement, who look like this incredibly single-minded, we're just, you know, we interrupt speakers, we do this, but mm-hmm. they were very interested mm-hmm. in actually having dialogue. So that was part of their strategy.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so where do we ask Professor Wilentz to
comment? What I would add, though, no, look, really, really talented egalitarians are good politicians. Really talented politicians are good at egalitarians. That's where the ground where they meet. Sidney Hillman, to use a labor leader, but boy, oh boy, he was intensely political. There are always these people who are on the cusp of both, and they move in and out, and they're very, very, they're crucial to what the story is about.
Yep. Well, we have one all the way down in front, so we... wait for the mic, because it's
there's
on,
a microphone
on air. Here it comes. Thank you.
So it was a great talk.
Thank you.
Really interesting. I was just wondering, it seems like most of the politicians you pick are individuals who are seen as, nationally elected politicians who, have to make certain concessions who may not be true egalitarians in terms of their convictions. But what about people like William Jennings Bryan, Robert LaFollette, mm-hmm. Huey Long, individuals who had great electoral success and even seemed poised for national, successes in certain senses, but ultimately sort of fell short. Like, why don't we think of them as the politicians and the egalitarians? And why do we think of people like, FDR, who was someone who was really a patrician?
Right, mm-hmm. Yeah. I suppose in the course of a short book, I only wanted to go with the people who really... But someone like Bryan's very important, for example, right? I mean, Bryan runs for president four times. He's very political, but he comes out of a very particular strand inside the Democratic Party. In fact, he is a Democrat rather than a populist, and he brings them both together. Yeah, I mean, it's a very, very, the cavalcade is great, and a full history along these lines would include all of those people. What do we do about Huey Long? It's more difficult. I mentioned, but don't talk about in great detail, Senator Robert Wagner, who was, as important to the New Deal as anybody, and, he wasn't a president, but he was very, very important. And, Senator Wagner first got involved in reform politics around labor with the Triangle Fire, very early on. He's a Tammany Paul coming up, but he has this burning idea. So there's another example of what this is like. Egalitarians, it's a tradition that it's not monolithic. It doesn't always go in the same direction. I suppose you could build one that goes Jefferson, Lincoln, Roosevelt. I don't like building those bridges because history's too complicated. But there are many, many others in there, some of whom succeed, some of whom, like Bryan, fail. And there are partial egalitarians. I mean, William Jennings Bryan was an extraordinary man at propounding the interests of down-and-out agricultural laborers, but he wasn't very good on issues of culture. And he wasn't very good on tolerating, on religious tolerance, for example. So there are admixtures as well. None of these people is perfect. I go back to Jefferson, best example of all, who was, the egalitarian slaveholder. You know, there are contradictions that we live that become even more glaring with the passage of time. The chapter about Jefferson I'm trying to do is actually rescue him because he's thought of as only a slaveholder these days. And you know, if that was true, then why would we care about him at all? And we don't care about him because he was a slaveholder. We care about him because he wrote the Declaration of Independence and did a great deal more to open up American democracy. But there are always these admixtures, so I don't want to make it too... American history is endlessly fascinating. Right? It's the most fascinating of all because there are so many different nationalities, so many things going on. It's fantastic. It's short, but it's busy. So, you know, in the fullness of time, one would take all of that stuff.
Norton Garfinkel has a question.
There's another theme that's analogous to the one that you've written here. You could perhaps call it the politicians and the business people, or the politicians and the non-egalitarians. And that has a similar question associated with it, which is how do the non-egalitarians and politicians interact with each other? Strangely enough, they may interact with each other similarly to the way in which, in terms of the political process, as this, but there is that other theme.
Yes.
And I think we need a sense of how that other theme is working to have the best sense of how this theme is working.
That's an excellent point, which I'd like to give more thought to, actually. But, you know, you think about national politics, the ways in which, I don't know, Marcus Hanna, for example, went about figuring out how to build a political machine using the less than egalitarian, shall we say, interests involved. You know, all the way up to the rise of the counter-establishment in the 70s and 80s, where, you know, a virtual, you know, Potemkin intelligentsia was, not intelligentsia, academia was built up in order to push certain kinds of pro-business politics. So yes, there is another history called the politicians and the anti-egalitarians. And I hope someone writes that book. You want to start? It's a great idea. And it's true, this story will not be fully told until that book is written. I mean, I think that's the point.
Yes, ma'am.
If Bernie Sanders is advocating egalitarianism, and egalitarianism is good for the preponderance of the people, then why didn't the preponderance of the Democratic Party people vote for Bernie Sanders? And in summary, what's the matter with California?
I take it you're a supporter of Senator Sanders. Okay. What I think that the senator did extraordinarily well in terms of issues, let's forget about the politics of it, was to bring to bear foremost attention, fierce attention on two basic issues. One is the very fact of American inequality. Now, I wouldn't exactly frame it the way that Senator Sanders did. I think that the gap between the real gap is not between the 1% and the 99%, in my view. It's between the top 20% and the rest of the country. I mean, where the top 20% is pulling away from the rest of the country with a rapidity. But that's just details. I think he, you know, in the aftermath of 2008, he focused on that speech after speech after speech and has changed the political terrain. The other was campaign finance reform, which he focused on again and again and again. But I think in the end, well, there were a bunch of reasons. I have no one reason. But the thing that I mentioned at the outset, the African-American vote. I mean, the African-American vote stuck with Hillary Clinton through thick and thin. And I think the reasons for that are many. Some of them have to do with old loyalties, but more than that. I think that African-American, well, it took a while for Senator Sanders to address that. It was a kind of, you know, inequality. The racial question is a sort of function of the inequality. Well, that's not, black people don't necessarily see it that way. But I also know that, especially in this political climate, African-American voters are very conscious about how fragile the gains that they've made over the last 50 years actually could be. They want to make sure that the Republicans are not going to be anywhere near the level, you know, the power, the kind of power that they could get if they simply elect the president. If the Republicans elect the president, no matter who he is, the Republicans control everything from top to bottom in American politics, including the Supreme Court, for, as far as the eye can see. I think African-American voters, which are a big part of the Democratic Party, were very, you know, very much trusted Clinton's approach and did not, were not hearing from Senator Sanders what they wanted to hear. I think if there's any one reason for why things turned out the way they did, I would credit that one.
Well, I'm about to invite all of you to a reception upstairs and a book signing. I know you want to get the book, but I will end. Don't leave yet. I want to end with two speculations. Well, a speculation and a quote. I can't help wondering, looking at you here and in the background, my friend Steve Schlesinger, who is here, about whether a historian who sees this track of history might, you don't have to answer, might join a White House brain trust as the greatest American historian Arthur Schlesinger did 55 years ago. But we'll leave that.
May I say that I admire Steve's father, as I admire Steve, greatly. And to be mentioned in the same sentence with, he's a far greater historian than I ever am going to be, to be mentioned in the same sentence, let alone paragraph, let alone sentence, with Arthur Schlesinger Jr. is a great, great compliment. I will say that.
It's a very political and politic answer. Thank you all. Come upstairs.
Thank you all.